you can think of this figure as kind of an owner's guide or an owner's manual to sedimentation. Things to consider are the geographic location and plate tectonic setting. This would include where you are on the Earth's surface from the equator to the pole. You're going to experience a dramatic change in climate that's going to affect weathering. Also, whether you're on the edge of a tectonic plate or in the middle of a tectonic plate, you're going to be exposed to very different agents, very different mechanisms for sedimentation, and different materials that are available to become sediment. We need to consider the transport agent and medium. Transport agents would be flowing water. They could be rainfall, wind, ice. They could be plants and animals as well. Organic processes and organisms that modify sediment. Organisms dig through sediment. We see that here with prairie dogs and ground squirrels. We can see organisms eating sediment. Earthworms consume sediment, goes in one end, it's processed to remove organic matter, and out the other end. In the meantime, it's undergoing chemical and physical changes within the worm's body. In terms of climate, we're going to go from relatively warm, wet climates at the equator to cool or frigidly cold, dry climates near the poles. These are going to generate different sedimentary environments, and as a result, the sediment that is generated by these mechanisms in these environments is going to be different. Starting with number one, lakes. In this case, we're looking at intermontane lake. We looked at an example from Premier Lake in British Columbia just recently, and we'll come back to that in a bit. The things to be concerned with here would be the types of material that are entering the lake, whether they're siliciclastic grains or dissolved ions. Number two, the rivers are going to be a transport mechanism from this lake. Suspended sediment and bottom sediment is going to be moved by the rivers to a more quiet location, whether that be a delta or maybe another lake or potentially a desert lake where water flows in but it doesn't flow out. Some famous examples of these types of lakes include the Great Salt Lake in Utah and the Black Rock Desert in Nevada. Burning Man, you may have heard of, that takes place in an old desert lake bed, one that's dried up most of the time. Moving on to glaciers as a mechanism for sediment transport and sediment generation, they're going to be scraping rock from the sides of these mountains. They're going to be producing generally U-shaped valleys, and the material they carry, the rock and mineral grains they carry, is going to be like an abrasive grinding its way down the valley. Eventually, this material again may reach a lake, or it may pile up in a delta on the shoreline. Now, for an example here, we have Premier Lake. These steep-sided slopes here are going to provide material that's generated by physical weathering. You can see a talus slope here. This is all loose material that's working its way down towards the lake. Although it's coming down as chunks and clasts and grains and boulders and cobbles and pebbles, it's also dissolving as it's sitting here in the rain and snow year after year. Those dissolved ions are going to reach this lake, and eventually they may be picked up by organisms in the lake and generate this blue bottom color. This can be the result of rock flour, fine-grained rock material coming from mountains, or it can be from algae that live in the lake, giving it this color. The North Thompson River in British Columbia serves as an example of a transport mechanism. Here we have the river obtaining grains and dissolved materials from the mountains and valleys upstream and carrying that material downstream towards the U.S. border ultimately. And here we have an example of a desert lake. Again, water flows in or falls on this surface, and the only way for it to leave is via evaporation back up into the atmosphere. As a result, the material that accumulates on the edges here, you can see alluvial fans. This is mostly feldspar grains and quartz. They're also dissolving, and those ions are going to enter the lake basin here. And we can see this whitish color that represents salt, in this case sodium chloride. So the sodium is being sourced from sodium-rich plagioclase feldspars up here, predominantly. and in the ionic state, it flows down into this lake and eventually gets concentrated as the lake waters evaporate. Now we're going to take a look a little further along here and focus on delta for a minute. These deltas are made up of sediment that's derived from elsewhere. In this case, we have a mountain lake supplying sediment and mountain glacier, intermontane glacier, generating clasts that are going to be pushed down the river to this delta. Eventually, this material can accumulate to enormous thicknesses, and because of the steepness of the slope here, if there's any tectonic activity, it can be shaken like a bowl of jello and turned loose into deeper water, generating turbidity currents that are going to be deposited as deep sea fans. Now, some of these can be very, very large and very thick. There's one off of southern India that is over 16 kilometers in thickness, 16 kilometers of sediment piled up there. Here we have an example of glaciers. This is in Antarctica, in the Antarctic Peninsula. You can see a very short glacier, but very active, that's ripping away pieces of this rock that surrounds it, and additional material entrained here. All this is going to be dumped in the Southern Ocean as this ice falls into the water and melts. This is another example from the opposite end of the Earth. This is the Vatnajökull in southeastern Iceland. This is the world's largest ice cap. It sits on top of a big volcano, and you can see it calving here in the distance. The material that's calved, these icebergs, contain enormous amounts of sediment. Because this is a mid-ocean ridge that's exposed, this is mid-ocean ridge basalt in the sediment here. Just like that basaltic sediment we saw on Deception Island, this is derived directly from the volcano via physical weathering. When we look at deltas and tidal flats, here we're using the example of the River Nile flowing into the Mediterranean Sea. We have a couple sub-deltas here. One, Butik Lake, and the other is Tanitik Lake, that are freshwater reserves. Personally, I wouldn't go swimming here because of the crocodile problem. But otherwise, these are really nice examples of a river delta. And you'll notice it's shaped like the Greek letter delta, which is why it has the name delta. Now, tidal flats are going to be regions that are variably covered by water at high tide and exposed at low tide. Now, putting this together, we can start with continental environments here and looking at the transport agent, lake currents and waves that are going to be pushing the material, in a lot of cases back and forth, rubbing the sharp edges off and rounding the grains. Types of sediment that will result are sand and mud. In the case of desert lakes, we can have saline precipitates and things like salt. The climate can be arid to humid, so anything from very wet to very dry. Biological processes that are important include freshwater organisms that stir up the material, other organisms that make material, and that material ultimately accumulates as sedimentary rock. In alluvial environments, our main transport mechanism is going to be gravity and flowing water. The types of material generated include sand, mud, and gravel. These are found in arid to humid environments. The example we used was Death Valley, which is an arid environment. And biological processes that may or may not influence this type of deposit include organic matter in muddy flood deposits and wetlands, and no organic matter in dry desert environments, or very, very little. When we get deserts, the main mechanism of transport is wind. There's not much rain, if any, so the only thing moving is the air. The types of material that are found there would include sand and dust. Again, this is an arid climate, and essentially no biological activity, nothing significant in terms of the sedimentology anyway. In glacial environments, ice and meltwater are going to be the mechanisms to move material. In the case of the Vatnajökull in Iceland, when that volcano goes off, more ice is melted and released than all the fresh water in all the rivers of the world. That could last for a couple weeks. So enormous amount of meltwater comes flashing out of there at times of eruptions. The material moved can be sand, mud, and gravel. Not a gravel, but gravel. And in the case of a Jokalaup, when the volcano erupts under ice, the blocks of material can be the size of a school, essentially. The climate is cold, and there's little biological activity as a result of this cold climate. When we talk about shoreline environments, again, the transport agents are going to be river currents and waves in delta settings, sand and mud as the sediment. The climate can be arid to humid because the material is supplied from somewhere else. It can travel through an arid region. So the Nile is sourced in a humid area, the Ethiopian highlands, and it travels through the Egyptian desert, where the delta ultimately forms. The burial of plant debris can be a significant component of these sediments, and this is going to be plant debris that's generated right next to the river. Beach deposits are moved by waves and tidal currents. These include sand and gravel predominantly, and beach deposits can occur in climates that range from arid to humid. Little biological activity on a beach. There are burrowing crabs and worms, but they do little real sedimentological work to influence the ultimate deposit. In tidal flats, these materials are subject to the movement by tidal currents. The materials are sand and mud predominantly. These tidal flats can appear in environments ranging from arid to humid. And in this case, organisms are going to be significant agents in the mixture of the material. They're constantly mixing, bioturbating the sediment. In marine environments, the transport agent is going to be ocean currents, and in some cases, as we'll see, turbidity currents, more dramatic examples. Sediment is going to consist of mud and sand predominantly, but it can also be gravel. Biological processes include the deposition of the remains of plants and animals. On the continental shelf, waves and tides are the predominant transport mechanism, and sand and mud is the predominant sediment material. The deposition of the remains of organisms is also significant in some instances. In the case of organic reefs, waves and tides are going to be the dominant transport and modification mechanisms. Sediment can include calcified organisms predominantly, with some organic matter. And the biological processes include secretion of carbonates by corals and other organisms, predominantly algae. And last but not least, at number 11, the continental margin slope environment. Here, ocean currents and, to a very limited degree, waves are going to influence and transport sediment. Sediment is going to be predominantly mud and sand, with some deposition of the remains of plants and animals. So here we have an alluvial depositional environment, and these mountains are being broken down physically. You can see the piles of predominantly feldspars here in these alluvial fans. They're called fans because they're fan-shaped. And in addition to the piling and movement of this material physically, we have the chemical dissolution of this material. If these are dominantly plagioclase feldspars that are sodium-rich, we're going to put a lot of sodium ions into this desert lake. When this desert lake dries up, as it does, we end up with halite deposits. In this case, in Death Valley, it's called the Devil's Golf Course. It's a salt deposit that actually makes noise. It creaks and moans and groans, and it pops because the temperatures are so high in the daytime. In the case of a turbidity current, we have an example here of a deep sea fan. This is the Bengal fan. You can see that compared to the size of India, this Bengal fan is about the size of the United States, the continental United States, which is a pretty big pile of sediment. It can be up to 16.5 kilometers in thickness, and as you can see, it is a very, very significant deposit. Its source is the uplift of the Himalayas and the physical weathering of the Himalayas by rivers that include the Ganges and the Brahmaputra, most predominantly. So these two major rivers drain the Himalayas, along with the Indus River, And all of that sediment that's generated by the uplift of the Tibetan Plateau is going to drain here. It's going to pile up here near the shore. And when it's destabilized by tectonic activity, it gets shaken up like adding a Mentos to a Diet Coke. And it just blows out here into the Indian Ocean. When we talk about environments of siliciclastic sediment deposition, we talked about continental environments, alluvial settings, desert settings, lake settings, and glacial activity all serve to move and deposit siliciclastic sediment. In shoreline environments, deltas, beaches, and tidal flats represent repositories and mixing vats for siliciclastic sediment. In the marine environment, we have siliciclastic sediment accumulating on the shelves, on the margins, the slope, and if shaken off the slope, into the deep sea. As for environments of chemical and biological sediment, we have carbonate deposits such as organic reefs. These can appear in marine settings. They can also appear in freshwater settings, as we'll see. Beach deposits, wherever there's water adjacent to land, we can move some carbonate material around. In this case, the carbonate material is made up of the dead plants and animals that reach the beach and get broken up and modified there. This material can slide off of the beach onto a shelf, and it can also accumulate in tidal flats where the tide comes in and the tide goes out. It comes in and goes out. That happens twice a day, moving the material back and forth twice a day. And we have siliceous environments in the deep sea, most significantly in the Central Pacific. There's carbonate being produced in the surface waters as well as organic matter, not very much, but it's being produced. As it sinks through the deep water in the Pacific, it breaks down. And ultimately, the only material left is siliceous material. So you get what's called a siliceous ooze in the middle of the Pacific. And then we have evaporite deposits in lakes, where lakes dry up. Also, marine environments and marginal marine environments can dry up, as we'll see an example of the Mediterranean Sea.